Welcome to the AC Small Experiments podcast, where we have conversations with University of Groningen instructors to inquire about what they have been testing, tweaking, or trying out in their teaching and learning activities, and what they observed and learned about themselves and their students in the process. Our guests for episode 3 are Tom Wigham and Allison Crawford, lecturers in the Faculty of Arts, European Languages and Culture. They have been teaching courses primarily related to increasing student levels of English proficiency and development of academic and writing skills. Our conversation took place on July 14, 2020, and has been edited for length. Combined, Tom and Allison taught 3 courses between March and the end of June, giving them a unique level of experience and reflection about online pandemic teaching. They tried an innovative approach to one of those courses, combining efforts and teaching together. In this episode, they share about the ways in which they were creative with online tools and worked together collaboratively, as well as how they maintained an inspiring, thoughtful, and student-centered approach throughout it all. Well, Tom and Allison, thank you so much for agreeing to talk to us about your experience with online teaching. It's really nice to have you joining the podcast.
Thanks for having us.
Maybe could you tell us a little bit about the course that you were teaching? Because you were co-teaching a course together online. Is that correct?
Yes. So the program that we're teaching in has 3 English courses. So I taught the first course, English 1, then Tom and I co-taught English 2, and he also taught English 3.
And this was all since March when we've been in online teaching mode.
Yeah, as Allison said, we've been co-teaching that one, and not just in the sense that we've been teaching on the same course, but we actually decided to put our classes together. So to basically try and amalgamate our groups so that we could both be present in any one given seminar.
Is that something you had planned already to do if it were face-to-face instruction, or is this more a decision you made once we moved into online mode?
Yeah, this was something, so originally we would have our own groups, and while we did a lot of collaboration and we taught basically the same course, it was still quite separate. When we switched to online learning, once we realized that the focus on asynchronous learning would be prioritized, we thought as much as we can kind of alleviate the stress on ourselves and the stress of working online, if we can collaborate, so if we can consolidate, we had originally wanted to actually consolidate both groups into one session. But that proved impossible for their schedules. So instead, we had back-to-back sessions where both of us were present, as well as an intern as well. So we kind of formed a group of teachers for the full block for both groups. And one of us would take the lead, but the other was also there to kind of moderate the chat and work in the background.
Mm-hmm. That's a really nice strategy. You mentioned a predominant focus on asynchronous, which I'm really curious about, because I think when we go into emergency remote teaching, as many of us did in March, the inclination is that we just take what we've been doing, maybe our 3-hour lecture, and we just move that to an online format, which I think many people quickly realized it's not really as simple as it sounds, and it's difficult for people to sit through long lectures and things through technology. So it sounds like you made a conscious choice to do more asynchronously, which I think is fantastic and definitely recommended from all the things that I've been reading and practicing myself. So could you tell a little bit more about how you decided that and how you structured things in your course?
Well, I think that we were quite lucky actually to get that pretty much that advice very early on. So within the language learning group, we were advised that actually what we should try and do is have students meet the learning outcomes, and that the amount of time that students spent face to face with us was really up to us to decide. But we were also advised that, you know, long sessions online are probably not a good idea. So as much as possible, we tried to condense our materials rather than having them in 2 sessions in 1 week. We tried to condense them into 1 session a week. That also made it more practical for us so that we could co-teach. And so that was how we came to this arrangement, that we would both be in the same group, that we would teach together. And how that actually worked out, we ended up having most sessions, I think, still lasting around 2 hours. And I think that's maybe something which we could consider doing differently for next year. But I think overall, the idea of having just one session, a shorter period of time face to face overall per week, was a good one. And what we basically did is we looked at what we really could help students with. So in what ways would students actually benefit from interaction with the teacher and with each other? And I think that was the starting point for what we did collaboratively. Anything else, anything that involved, for example, lower levels in Bloom's taxonomy. So if they were just recalling information, if they were trying to understand, even a lot of application that didn't necessarily need a teacher to be present, that could all basically go online and be done asynchronously. So I think the guiding principle was only keep those activities which are really essential for the teacher to be there, or for other students really to be present.
Yeah, I think that summarizes how we came to this strategy. As you mentioned, really early on, I think either the chair or someone else in the language learning department shared a kind of flow chart, which had recommendations for online learning. So basically, do this, not that. And I think the first one was, do asynchronous learning. Don't try to just replant your physical classroom and put it online, because it's not the same. And as a lot of us found out, trying to do that kind of thing will lead to a lot of stress. So we've got technical issues, sitting in front of a computer, distractions. It's very different. Mm-hmm. Timing is different. Attention span is different. So yeah, as you mentioned, everything that can be done autonomously, asynchronously, we thought about that and we had that done. And what I think it's really helped us achieve is this idea that we've had before of trying to have a flipped classroom, and where the students are learning for themselves at home and then bringing questions or other issues, or really working on problems or workshops or things like that in class time. This online environment has kind of forced us to achieve that.
Yeah, I agree with you. And I think that's a really nice strategy, and something I recently said to some Faculty of Science and Engineering professors I was working with, was to kind of think about your online class like a faculty meeting. Like, how often have we sat in meetings of any kind, really? It doesn't have to be a faculty meeting, but and then we're kind of thinking, all of this information could have been shared in an email. I don't need someone to read it to me in a meeting. And that's sometimes, I think, how our students feel, especially in an online format. So anything you can put, like if it were a meeting, in an email, but in your course asynchronous, then why not do it that way? And then really, really be, judicious about your synchronous time in how you use it, and very intentional in how you plan it for more conversations and communication that needs to happen in real time. Many of our students, we don't know what their home situations are like or where they're coming from or studying. Some might be still in their home country because maybe they're not able to travel back to Groningen. Some might be sharing one computer with multiple family members who are working or studying at home, or some might only have a phone or intermittent access to Wi-Fi. So giving a lot of asynchronous options is definitely helpful, because then they can access it when it works.
I think, Tracy. I think, as Allison said, it's interesting that actually this is something which we've been trying to achieve beforehand. And I think more than anything, this situation really forced us to narrow our focus and really make hard choices about what needed to be kept in and what needed to be taken out. So I think actually, if and when we go back into physical classrooms, hopefully some of that will stay with us. We'll also be able to make more effective decisions about what the real added value of face-to-face interaction is. And probably that there's actually a lot more than we thought that can actually be achieved online. I think one other thing that I would be curious to try is working more on having shorter sessions and actually splitting up groups. So in the end, in English 2 that we taught together, I think we had groups of around 17, 18 students. And in one of my other courses, I think there were a total of 24 students in together. And one of my ideas is that if we reduce the amount of time that we actually spend teaching a lesson from, say, 2 hours to 1 hour, that actually what we can then do is have 2 1-hour sessions back to back. So you then split the group in half and basically spend less time with fewer people. And I'm wondering if implementing that will actually improve the quality of the interaction, that students will feel that they're a bit closer to the instructor and to each other, that they'll have a bit more time to work with each other. So that's something which I'd be interested to experiment with. And the other thing which I think is, which I'm trying to bear in mind is one piece of feedback which we got from students. They obviously have many different courses and different instructors are trying out different materials, different platforms, different apps, and that actually can be very confusing and that it takes an awful lot of time to get to grips with these things. And I think then sometimes there's something to be said for the simplicity of sticking with the Nestor environment, using add-ons there as much as possible, and maybe actually using external applications sparingly so that students don't have quite so much to work on in terms of getting to know new technology well. So that's maybe a more conservative approach, but I think using the Google Suite and the Nestor applications that are already there can be quite helpful for the students in that regard.
That's a very important thing to keep in mind about our students. And I'm glad that you're finding the tools that we already have at our disposal useful. So you mentioned Nestor and our G Suite tools. Can you tell us a little bit more about how you really found those useful or how you use them effectively?
Yeah, in terms of Google, I think that we do try to focus on using the G Suite, which the students are mostly familiar with, and they all have equal access to it. So one thing that we've done, and this we've done before we moved online, but it's become really valuable since moving online, is Google Documents. So we've had our students upload, for example, writing assignments or drafts of essays or outlines as a Google document in a shared Google Drive folder, maybe shared with the whole class, maybe shared with a certain group of just their peer group. And that way they can edit and review each other's documents in real time, save changes in real time, access everything all the time. So Google Documents and the Google Drive folder, I think we've used the most. Also for sharing things like audio files and video files for things like they've recorded podcasts and other audio recordings, pair presentations. And we've used Google Forms for just informal evaluation from the students. Tom's put together some nice evaluation forms using Google Forms.
But I think I would agree, Allison, that the Google Docs is really something which is very powerful. And I think one of the things that we really enjoyed was the fact that if students are working on a Google Doc collaboratively, that more or less tells us what they're doing. And it even sometimes saves the need to go into their breakout rooms and work out what's being said, because if it's a task which requires them to put down their thinking on paper, we can basically just dot in and out of their Google Docs and see what they're working on, what their ideas are. And that makes it very easy for us to keep tabs on what they're doing and provide feedback.
Yeah, so we can even comment on them while they're working without having to interrupt their conversation. So yeah, that has been really handy.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, absolutely. I think it's also one of those things that that we become so familiar with through using it that I'm speaking for myself here, but I sometimes tend to forget that students may not actually be familiar with how the Google Suite works. They may be familiar with their email, but maybe not more than that. So for example, recently I had a student who contacted me to say that they'd left lots of beautiful comments for peer review in somebody else's document and they couldn't view any of them. And it turns out that this student hadn't actually been clicking the send comment button once they'd written their comments. So they'd gone through a whole document, written all of their comments out, and actually they hadn't saved a single one. And I think that that's maybe the kind of thing that I start to take for granted after a while. So I think one thing with using the Google Suite is really making sure that students know how to use it in advance. So I think something that we both started to experiment with a bit is coming up with instructional videos to show students how to use the Google Suite. So I think powerful as a tool as it can be, it's also something which students will need some instruction with to make sure that they can use these competently.
That's a good point, because I think often we assume, you know, oh, they're all so savvy with technology. They're comfortable with technology, but maybe they actually haven't used these tools for a purpose. They consume a lot through their devices, but don't always create a lot through their devices. So this is a shift for them as well. So I like very much that you made some resources for them to understand what needed to be done. Something else I've also heard from a few colleagues or different groups that I follow is maybe using Google Slides for an introduction slide deck, and everyone gets their own slide, maybe to upload a photo or add some information about them, and then have students comment on each other's slides, just as something that's a little less pressure, where they get to practice using some of the features and functions for the first time.
Slides would also be a great idea. I haven't personally used the slides collaboratively in such a way, but it's a lot harder to get that introduction to each other online. So something like uploading photos in Google Slides, or even as simple as a small video introduction or having the camera on during the seminar, all those things I think will be even more important when we're meeting students for the first time.
It's also one of the things which I think was most difficult during this period is working out how interaction works online. And I think a lot of the social interaction, just kind of making students feel comfortable and being able to share things about yourself or ask them to share things about each other, that was much more difficult. And that's something I think, well, for my part, I'm still experimenting with.
And it's one of the most commonly asked questions to our team. The top two things always are, how do we build community with our students, and how do we add interactivity into our online lessons? So it sounds like you were doing a lot of that really well. Did you also provide a lot of feedback to your students?
I think another thing that we both done quite a lot is use rubrics in Nestor to give feedback. And that's proved very helpful.
Yeah, the rubrics were also something that we had used previously, but I think we and the students became more reliant on them now because we don't have as much opportunity to explain things during class or between classes. So we kind of revamped our rubrics, I guess, to make them as detailed as possible. And within, then again, Nestor, so the students are already familiar with it when they upload their assignments or drafts of their assignments. And then they can see, you know, is this on the right track, insufficient, sufficient, good. They can see a rubric evaluation as well as additional comments if necessary.
So those types of things, will you continue using them if we are able to go back to a fully on-site education model?
Yeah, I think we'll certainly continue using things like Google Documents and Google Drive for sharing. And I think for things like Google Forms, in terms of getting feedback from the student to check in with students, how's it going and what can we change? The students had some suggestions of things that we could change, which we did. And so even if we go back to in-person teaching, I think those moments for feedback will also still be valuable.
Yeah, it's nice that you asked for feedback early on. I love that you really take into account your students' perspective so much in not overwhelming with tools or with asking even a few weeks in, how is this going for you, and listening to their feedback. Because I know all of us are very focused on how do I do my job as an educator in a very quick transition to online teaching, and we're kind of in firefighting mode, I call it. But sometimes we get so wrapped up in our own worries about our instruction that we forget to ask our students for for how is it working for them? And I love that you did that. What were some of the top comments that you found useful from your students?
Yeah, they had really nice suggestions, which also makes it easier for us. So we don't have to guess if what we're doing is effective or not. So from what I remember, one of their suggestions was to make the PowerPoints accessible before the seminar. So we had a practice of posting the slides after the seminar, but some of them, due to technical difficulties, other issues, they wanted to have them before. So maybe they could download them and go along on their own. So we made them available before the seminars. And something else, they were used to working in the same groups. So they were meeting with each other outside of class as well in their same groups. And so they asked if they might also work in different groups during the seminar. And we had kind of been used to just, okay, well, now they're working in their groups, so we'll put them in the same groups, and hadn't really thought maybe they would like to work with some of their other peers when we're in class as well. So those were two. I'm not sure if you remember any more of the suggestions that they had, Tom.
I think the only other one that really came out was the length of the time that we were giving students to complete the tasks in breakout rooms. Mm-hmm. And I think the general consensus, if I remember correctly, is that they needed more time on average than less. And I think we more or less shifted to the idea that the shortest breakout room session that was reasonable was usually about 15 minutes to give students time to complete the tasks which we were assessing them. I think one of the other things that came out of the evaluation, not so much in terms of feedback which was actionable, but feedback to us, was that students were very, very grateful for the fact that we tried to put everything online quickly, and that we were making an effort. I think they really appreciated that, and it was really, that was a really nice moment, I think, just to hear that they understood the difficulties of the situation, that they were aware of the problems that we were facing as well, and that they were very glad that we were trying to tackle them. And I think that's also interesting, because I think later in the block, the nature of the evaluation perhaps changes when students are under more pressure. Particularly if they've got exams which they're facing. And I think then it is nice to poll them earlier on during the block, because it maybe gives a different snapshot in time of how students are feeling. And it maybe tells us more about how they're experiencing the classes than about other issues like assessment, which are probably weigh very heavily on students' minds towards the end of the course.
That's a really good point. What are some things you're still thinking about or curious about or pondering over?
I think one thing that I'm still wondering about is how useful it is for the students to have an immediate support network of peers. I think in practice, in our courses, students end up working in small groups almost throughout the block. So for example, in the course that we taught on English 2, the students not only had to do their oral defense as an assessment at the end of the block, but they had to work in those oral defense groups, giving peer feedback on each other's essays all the way throughout the block. They had to meet with each other on a fairly regular basis. And I'm thinking that that's, on balance, probably a good way to ensure that students feel connected, at least, if not to the instructor, then at least to somebody, that they have a regular point of contact. That said, I think it's sometimes when you're working in small groups like that, it can also become difficult if not all group members are working equally, or if the students perceive that there are differences in the amount of work that each of them is putting in. And so something which we've also kind of lightly experimented with using are kind of contracts, learning contracts, so that the students at the beginning of a course, they have to sign or agree within their group a group of procedures which they will use. So for example, you know, what days of the week are you available to meet? What times of the day are you available to meet? How quickly should you respond to messages? How long can you leave a message unread before this becomes unacceptable? And basically have them draw up their own kind of learning contract for their group and agree to it. And that's something that I think in English 3, we experimented with this a little bit, and it was partially successful. I think probably it would have been more successful if we'd revisited this more and had the students kind of evaluate how they were performing in relation to the goals they'd set themselves. And so that's something that I'm still wondering how best to achieve that kind of that sense of community within small groups and avoid there being tension within a group if they're working with each other over a prolonged period of time.
That sounds like a really nice strategy for establishing norms. So this is how we're going to work together as a group or as a community. Sometimes we forget that we need to have that explicitly sort of outlined. Otherwise, people don't know. So again, a lot about, yeah, assuming what do people know already, whether it's about tools or behaviors or any of the above, and ensuring that is made really clear at the beginning. I think that's a really wonderful idea. I'm so glad you're thinking about that.
Yeah, I really like the idea of having a contract for the students, and it kind of goes along with what my questions or main concerns are for the future in this sort of environment, which is just expectations in general for students. So I think that's something that we struggled with this transition, and something I heard from the students in their end of the course evaluations was that they had so much more work at home and that they had different experiences and different expectations in different courses. So I think being super clear in the beginning of the course about things like, this is how many hours you should spend on your work outside of class. You should have a schedule for yourself, especially if you're doing most of your studying or working from home, working with others. What are the expectations? Also being in class, something like have your webcam on, be sitting in a chair. All of these things that we didn't think about at the beginning would be good to think about more.
Yeah, indeed. What did you find helpful or useful from your, you mentioned you had a lot of guidelines or advice from your department or your faculty. What did you learn from some of your colleagues or from some of those meetings that was most valuable to you?
So the language learning team put together a whole document on online teaching and things that should, as far as we know, according to research, things that we should be doing and things that we probably shouldn't be doing. So that was really, really useful.
Yeah, I think something that was really valuable that I believe came from the educational support team was the structure, the suggestion of structuring Nestor. We had already had it structured by weeks. That was something that the department did last year, I believe. But then with the online format, I think the suggestion was to structure it, okay, week one, step one, step two, et cetera, et cetera. And the students also seem to like that a lot because it gives them a kind of checklist of this is what I need to do in this order this week. And it even included, you know, step three would be attend the webinar at this time. And for English 2, we had it further organized into before the seminar, during the seminar, after the seminar. And that that came from the support team or one of the webinars. I think I got the format from that, and it was very helpful.
Well, I'm glad to hear that. I like that you're so student-centered in the way that you thought about designing things. So I think and I hope this will be valuable to many people in our community. And I just want to thank you again for taking the time to talk to us today about all of the wonderful things that you're doing and how focused you are. Again, I just love how focused you are on your students' experience. And I think that's just lovely and how education should be. So thank you.
Well, thanks again for having us. It's nice to have another moment to reflect on what we've been doing and to look ahead.
Great.
Absolutely. And thanks for your tips as well, Tracy.
Educational Support and Innovation, or ESI, is the central instructional support team for all educators at the University of Groningen. To find out more about the services and resources we have made available during this interesting time in the world and in academic education, please visit www.ruch.nl/education/online-teaching.